The next speaker, I think is Naoto Hirano. His title is Engineered T-Cells in Cancer Therapy, CAR-T, TCR-T, and Others. Naoto is a hematologist oncologist trained in and a PhD trained at the University of Tokyo. I've known Naoto for more than a decade. We first met as postdocs in Lee Mather's lab in Dana-Farber. He has really been a major force for trying to think of ways to inducing T-cell responses and figuring out better ways to measure and generate new strategies for adoptive cell therapy. So.
This is the poster. Hi, so I'm Naoto. I'm a senior scientist at the Princess Margaret. And today, I'd like to talk about the engineering of T cells for the purpose of the adoptive T cell therapy. And I have some conflict interests that I need to disclose. Okay, so as Marcus introduced, in adoptive T cell therapy, we isolate the T cell from the patients. And in the lab, we stimulate the T cell with in a couple of ways and expand them and then infuse them back to the patient who received the lymphodepletion, mostly consisting of cyclophosphamide or fludarabine. So during this the time period where the T cells are in the lab, we have an opportunity to manipulate or engineering the T cell to make a high quality T cell which can fight against the tumors. So the first talk, the part is done by Mune, one of my super postdocs, and he works on the gene engineering of the T-cell receptors affinity. So just a brief summary of the current status of T-cell receptor gene therapy. It's basically defined as adoptive transfer T-cell engineered to by the transfer anti-tumor high-quality T-cell receptor genes. And the first paper was published in 2006. And since then, the antigen has been targeted by the strategies, including A2 and A2N4 with the different antigen. And importantly, some clinical responses observed, but not very impressive. And the problem is that sometimes we saw the severe toxicity, sometimes lethal toxicity caused by mainly the T-cell receptor cross-reactivity. So at the current, the issue with the T-cell receptor gene therapy is that how we can improve the anti-tumor reactivity of the T-cell receptor. At the same time, we have to reduce, the autoreactivity of the T-cell receptor, which is, inherent, the attribute of T-cells not easy to deal with. Okay, so as you may know that because of thymic selection and peripheral tolerance, majority of T-cell receptors in the periphery have a low to intermediate affinity to the self-antigen, in many cases, tumor antigen, self-antigen. So DMA5 and 1G4 and DMA5, these are the T cell receptors actually used in clinical trials. And compared to the T cell receptor affinity of a foreign antigen, viral specific antigen, it's obvious that affinity of T cell receptor is very low. So one of the tasks that we need to address in the lab is how we can increase affinity of T cell receptor, in other words, avidity of the T cell. So as you may know that the T-cell receptor consists of the alpha and the beta chains, so it's a heterodimers, and the alpha and the beta together, they recognize a peptide presented by HLA. But if you look at the structure data, in many cases, there's a dominance in either alpha chain or beta chain to recognize peptide MHC complex. So in fact, in the mice, there has been such the report of T-cell receptor. So this is a case of alpha chain centric T cell receptor. Against the one clone tipped alpha chain, there are many, many beta chains can make a pair and recognize the same antigen with different affinities. In the case of the beta chain centric T cell receptor, one clone tipped beta chain receptor, the multiple alpha chain can make a pairing and recognize the same peptide MHC complex with a different affinity. So several years ago, we decided to seek after develop a new strategy to develop the isolated high affinity T cell receptor. And our thinking was, if we introduce an antigen-specific chain-centric T cell receptor hemichain, introduce a peripheral blood, basically we can make a completely new pair which didn't go through the thymic selection. Probably these T cell receptors have a very high affinity to very low affinity against the tumor antigen. So as a proof of concept, we initiated a study with A2MALT1 T cell receptor, which is a very famous T cell receptor. And we knew that, against this one T cell receptor, alpha gen, multiple beta gen has been reported from independently from different labs that they can recognize A2MALT1 with a different affinity. So using this alpha gen, we introduce only alpha gen into the peripheral blood to A2 patients and A2 negative patients, only alpha chain. And it looks like many peripheral blood can be converted to A2MALT1 specific using the endogenous beta chain, okay? So obviously, we can see the same, similar phenomenon with from both A2 positive and A2 negative donor, which means that this strategy can overcome the thymic selection, HLA restriction namely. So there's the superposer cloned hundreds of beta chain, and he reconstituted those, the beta chain with a single clonotypic alpha chain to characterize, T cell receptor. So this is, DMA5, the A2MALT1 T cell receptor, using clinical trials. But compared to them, apparently we have a different, the T cell receptor with various affinities. We measured the functional ability and structural ability, and compared to the DMA5, the half of them have the better ability when they reconstituted on the T cell. And interestingly, this is a stain with the tetramer, and this is a stain with monomer, the HLA complex. As you know, the interaction between T cell receptor and HLA peptide complex is so the weak. We have to multimerize, the A2 peptide complex to have the stable interaction with the cognate T cell receptor. So, but this is the tetramer is so usually used to detect in a cognate T cell receptor. But our T cell receptor, even the monomer, can have a stable interaction with the T cell receptor, which means that they have a very, very high affinity, like an antibody. So we tested, this T cell receptor in terms of tumor reactivity and cross reactivity, and we don't have time, so we just showed the tumor reactivity. But compared to DMA5, our very high T cell receptor can recognize tumor cells in the absence of CD8, and in the presence of CD8, including DMA5, majority of these T cell receptors can recognize the tumors. So it looks like, unlike DMA5, probably, these high-affinity receptors can make can recognize the tumors in the absence of CD8, which means that, when the T cell receptor introduce even a CD4 T cell, hopefully they can recognize the tumor cells. And, those CD4 T cells hopefully show the helper function. So we filed a patent application for this strategy, and working very hard to isolate many T cell receptor gene to be used in the adoptive T cell therapy. And we cloned many class 1 T cell receptor as well as in class 2 T cell receptor. And we are particularly interested in DPA4 because this is one of the most frequent HLA, and it's now the 75% of the Caucasian people are positive for DPA4. So this is a very good HLA target for the purpose of immunotherapy. So as Marcus briefly introduced, we just started the first in Canada A2 neocrystalline T cell receptor gene therapy at the Princess Margaret, and we'll target A2, which is one of the most frequent HLA, and unfortunately I'm not A2 positive. This is initiated by Dr. Marcus Butler, and we're going to test the feasibility and toxicity. And we're going to target nucleus 1, the tumors, which is a cancer test antigen and cloned by Lloyd Auld. And I'm going to touch on this, but importantly, we're going to use SITCR vector, which is a very specific vector to introduce the T cell receptor gene, and we are now screening for the patients. So nucleus 1, as I mentioned, it's a cancer test antigen, so it's expressed by various types of tumors. But the frequency is, you know, the synovial sarcoma, it is, you know, the percentage is very high. And the very interesting, you know, the expression pattern is not focal. Many of the tumors express, you know, the nucleus one. And other cancers, including the ovary and the melanoma, they express nucleus one at the rate of, you know, 30 to 40%. But sometimes, you know, expression pattern is focal, not ubiquitously expressed. So when we introduce a T cell receptor to the, you know, the T cell, we usually use a virus or non-virus, and one of the, you know, the virus we use is the retrovirus. So in the retrovirus vector, the T cell receptor alpha chain is driven by, you know, LTR in the, you know, vectors, and these T cell receptors transduce into a patient lymphocyte. And of course, the T cell, the patient lymphocyte, express endogenous T cell receptor. So when these T cells are introduced to, you know, the patient T cell, there are actually four types of T cell receptor created. And this is the one we want. This is endogenous T cell receptor. This is the T cell receptor so-called mispaired. And we don't know that, you know, what the antigen specificity of these mispaired T cell receptor. So in the worst situation, it may cause, you know, the reactivity to the, you know, oral, the self antigen, and may see the, you know, the adverse event as like an, you know, autoimmune response. So FDA and Health Canada, one of the things concerned about T cell receptor gene therapy is how we can reduce the expression of those mispaired T cell receptor, or knock down the T cell expression of mispaired the T cell receptor. So Takara Bio developed the new retrovirus vector, so-called SITCR vector. It's smart enough that this vector express an siRNA knocking down endogenous T cell receptor along with, you know, exogenous T cell receptor genes. So using this vector, when we introduce an alpha chain and beta chain, the T cell receptor, these, you know, the endogenous mispaired T cell receptor cannot be made because endogenous T cell receptor expression is suppressed by, you know, siRNA encoded by, you know, vector. So even if we use the same T cell receptor with the same affinity, our products with the T cell may have the higher avidity because we use this, you know, the special vector that can knock down the, you know, endogenous T cell receptor expression. So the next part is that talk about a new generation CAR, and which stands by the very smart, you know, the talented postdoc Yuki Kagoya. And this is a summary of the current status of the CAR T cell therapy. And basically, unlike the T cell receptor gene therapy, in the case of CAR gene therapy, we transduce the chimeric antigen receptor genes. And the first, you know, the CAR trial has been reported in 2006. And since then, CD19, as you know, 20 PSMA, GD2, EGF receptor, Barrett's for ACA, the folate receptor alpha, and the many CAR trials have been done. And you know, many of you guys may not know, but actually these many CAR trials have been done. But remember that the CD19 CAR is only CAR therapy which can induce very impressive responses. All the other CARs didn't show the very impressive, you know, the clinical activity. So this is, the CD19 CAR is exception. Many CAR therapy doesn't work. And as you may know, Marcus pointed out that cytokine release syndrome is a very toxic, you know, the side effects which can be associated with CD19, any CAR therapy, and also the T cell receptor gene therapy. We should forget that, okay, the, you know, cytokine release syndrome can take place even with the T cell receptor gene therapy. So, obviously, that, you know, as I said, that, you know, we have to improve the CAR therapy because, you know, so far the CD19 CAR is only CAR therapy that works. So one way to improve the, you know, the CAR therapy is that possibly to improve the CAR construct itself, the vector itself. So as you may not know, the T cell activation can be delivered through the, you know, the multiple signals. The first signal one is delivered by the CD3 T cell receptor complex. And signal two is delivered by the core signaling molecule like CD28 and 4-1BB or OX40. These, you know, the molecules intracellular domain has been used as, you know, the CAR. And also there's the signal three, which is mediated by cytokine, and the T cell receptor expresses cytokine receptor and receives the cytokine signal as a signal three. So the first generation obviously express only the, you know, the anti-tumor recognition domain, and the intracellular domain is, you know, the doesn't have any the significant domain. And unlike first generation, second generation have the at least one the sorry the one costimulatory domain which can deliver the costimulatory signal. The third generation have at least two costimulatory domains, and that can deliver, you know, augmented, you know, the intracellular signaling. So this first, you know, generation can deliver only signal one, and second, third generation can deliver two signals, which is signal one, two. In both generations, signal three is missing. So obviously, one way to improve the, you know, the generation is that probably integrate the signal three into the CAR. So many investigators, many groups, including our group, show that, okay, that, you know, the about, you know, the differential, you know, the function of different the cytokine receptors, and majority of the signals are mediated by common gamma chain, the cytokine, which is IL-2, 4-7, and 21. And based on, you know, preclinical work that we and other people conducted, we, you know, the interested in the IL-21, and especially the STAT3 delivered IL-21. Because the mouse studies are many, you know, the, even the human studies show that, you know, STAT3 is very important to generate the high-quality memory T cells. So this is a first-generation CAR, and they encode, you know, CD3 zeta chain and CD28, and this is FM63. It's a clone against, you know, the antibody clone name against CD19, which is, you know, most of the CD19 CAR trial used. And second, the third generation encode the 4-1BB and the C28. And this is our new generation CAR. And basically, we integrate IL-2 receptor beta chain and also, you know, the STAT3 associated motif. Basically, box one can recruit the JAK, the kinase, and there are two, you know, the phosphorylation site to which the STAT3 and STAT5 can bind. We had to, you know, it looks like pretty simple, but, you know, very difficult to generate, you know, the come up with this idea, because as you may know, when the intracellular domain is too long, that the T cell doesn't work, those in the receptor doesn't work in the T cell. So obviously this is a first generation, second generation, third generation, and only our generation, the new generation CAR, can have the STAT3 phosphorylation upon the CD19 at the antigen-specific, you know, the stimulation. And when you introduce these new generation CAR to the T cell, basically they have a very good, you know, the expansion, even absence of cytokine, and when the media was, you know, T cells are fed with IL-258, they have a better responses. And, you know, this is the CFS, this is, you know, saying, but even after, you know, the couple of weeks, they have a very good, you know, the proliferation. And importantly, looks like, you know, these new generation CAR T cells can expand well, but also the, you know, apoptosis rate is lower with this new generation CAR. We're also interested in that, okay, what's going to happen to if you repeatedly stimulate a T cell? Because as you may know that, you know, in vivo, the exhaustion of T cells is a big problem. In the tumor environment, you know, if they, you know, the T cells successfully enter the tumor microenvironment, they started working, they received, you know, they constantly receive the signal, stimulation signal from tumor cell. So, you know, the T cell can easily get exhausted and start expressing, you know, the PD-1 also, you know, losing the effector function such as interferon gamma secretion and also, you know, stop the proliferate. So after the repeated stimulation, our new generation CAR have, you know, the better tumor killing and also, you know, cytokine secretion capacity. And, you know, this is in vivo data using NALM-6, and this is, you know, gold standard of cell line to test, you know, efficacy of, you know, CD19 CAR in vivo. And unlike previous reports, we inoculated 5 million NALM-6. It's a huge number, okay? So a mouse has a lot of tumor burden, and that's why, you know, these previous, you know, the generation CAR immediately killed, you know, they couldn't, you know, rescue the, you know, those leukemic mice. But our new generation CAR, the CAR transit T cell, were able to rescue some of the mice, not perfect. So in addition to the, you know, the cell line, we also use the primary, the patient sample, of obviously, you know, CD19 positive ALL samples, we inoculated these primary cells into mice, and we did the comparison analysis between the third generation and our new generation car. And not only they persist very well, but at the same time they have the new generation car appear to have better anti-tumor efficacy or control the tumor growth. So we are very encouraged with this result and very eager to translate this new generation car into clinic. So hopefully this can happen at the Princess Margaret in Toronto. So the conclusion that, as I mentioned in the first part, that the T cell receptor chain centricity can be exploited as the high ability anti-tumor T cells, and also from the tetramer positive antigen specific population, we can easily clone in a counter chain, and by combining with the original the hemichain that we use as a bait, we can isolate, we can make, very high affinity anti-tumor T cell receptors. And also we just started a new T cell receptor gene therapy at the Princess Margaret using a new vector. And actually the health center loved this vector. And also we developed new generation CAR, which can deliver JAK-STAT, and they showed that better tumor effect in mice. So hopefully they can show the better effect in human beings. So the first part of the work is done by one of my first postdocs in Toronto, the Mune Nakatsugawa, and the second part is done by the postdoc Yuki Kaguya, and funded by the multiple agency. Thank you. Any questions?
Yeah, one question.
Okay.
Congratulations on the new generation.
Thank you.
As the originator of the second generation, this is spectacularly exciting to see. Have you seen any cytotoxicity related effects that would impact on the health of the animals?
Yeah, so the problem is this system, that this is the NSG mice. So eventually those T cells have a general reaction to the human T cell. So it's not always easy to see that what is CAR T cell specific adverse events taking place in the mice. But compared to the third generation, second generation, we didn't see obvious the differences in terms of the toxicity, but we never know. And obviously that this is a JAK-STAT, and as the STAT3 is oncogene, so for the safety probably we have to use a suicide gene when we put it into human beings. And yeah. Thank you.